And so what we do is we are all over the world, I mean 70 different countries, and we go into the location and work with a church or the denomination, or with an area of churches, and we equip them. We equip them with very simple tools that they can then turn around and evangelize, share the gospel simply, really simply, so that they might then disciple the people that they lead to Christ and their families and begin planting churches that plant churches that plant churches that plant churches. Not churches that have beautiful buildings like you have. Churches that are in a home that plant a church in another home that plant a church in another home. That kind of church. So we're 30 years old, and in 2016 we participated. We partner. We don't plant E3 churches. We partnered and planted almost 52,000 churches. That's praise to him, not praise to E3, not even praise to all the churches that planted the churches. So that's what we do. We're a part of that kind of a ministry. As you heard, my country that I focus on is Nigeria. And I just returned from Nigeria just a month ago. And I took a team of four of us, myself and three others, and we went in four locations, about three different states. And we trained people on what I just described, and there was 590 people that we trained. They all could begin planting churches that plant churches that plant churches that plant churches. So that's what we're doing. And I've been to Mexico recently. I've been to the men's prison. Central Men's Jail? That's what it is, in Los Angeles. I go down to Mexico and do ministry down there in prisons. This is something I'm doing with someone else. It's their ministry, and I'm just getting on the ride with them. And so I am seeing God work in my life and then also through my life everywhere I go. So I'm on mission, and it says 24/7, like you are. It's not because I'm a, quote, missionary. I'm a follower of Jesus. And so I'm on 24/7, like all of us are on 24/7, whether we're down at the higher grounds or we're at a workplace or a neighborhood or wherever we may be. I have the privilege of sharing with people about what God is doing in my life and what God has done in the world. And so just want to let you know about that. If you have more questions afterwards, I'd love to just talk with you and tell you more about the ministry. Thank you. Some of you are my prayer partners already. And so I want to thank you for that. If you wanted to be a prayer partner, Karen will be over there, that little part of the room right here. She'll be over there, and you can get a little thing and sign up to be a prayer partner and follow what we do along the way in our ministry. So thank you for your prayer support. I want to just start. Before we open the Word of God, I want to just start by praying, asking the Spirit to speak to each of us. So would you just bow your heart? You don't have to bow your head, but just bow your heart before the Lord. Father, here we are. We're just people. And we need to hear your Word. And I'm asking that as your Word is read and is quoted and as we talk about it, that you speak to our hearts. So, Holy Spirit, speak to us. Lord Jesus, by your Spirit, speak to me. Speak to each of us. And we ask, God, that you would be honored and glorified as we go through this time. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. I believe that Jesus is transforming our lives continuously. Continuously. I believe that God is redeeming even when we don't know he's doing that. I believe he's redeeming you and me and the world and the people who are doing okay and the people who are incredibly broken as I am, maybe as you might recognize you are, that he is redeeming us all the time in the circumstances that we're experiencing and especially in the ones that we don't see him doing that work. I have great news for you today, and it's about that, and I just hope that as we go through a couple of passages, that you're going to see that redemptive work throughout your life. As you look in the rearview mirror of your life, and you look by, I'm praying that God is going to help you and I to continually see the redemptive story that he's been doing in our lives. Jesus had siblings. Many people don't know that. They just think there was Mary and Joseph and Jesus, and that was the family, but that's not true. The Bible lists four of his brothers, James being the oldest of his brothers. He also had Joseph, Simon, and Judas, and then it says, and he had sisters. They're unnamed, and they're not numbered, so we don't know if there was two or three or what. We just know they're sisters, plural. So that means in the household that Jesus grew up in, there were at least seven children. Now, Jesus was the half-brother to all the rest of them. They all had an earthly father, but Jesus only had a heavenly father. He was the one immaculately conceived. But these brothers and sisters weren't Jesus' followers until after the resurrection. And the oldest brother, now younger than Jesus, but the oldest brother was James. And James became the leader, the head person of the church in Jerusalem after what's called the disbursement or the diaspora or the scattering. And James in Jerusalem, while Christians everywhere had scattered, you remember there was a persecution. Stephen was stoned to death, and then this great persecution happened, and anyone who was a Jewish Christian, a Christian in Jerusalem, fled, scattered. And James's brother writes a letter, a general letter. We call them epistles, but he wrote this letter to the people scattered abroad. And he wrote these words, James, a bond servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes who are scattered abroad, greetings. That's, hi, it's me. And then the next words are the most important words, I think, in this whole letter, one of my favorite letters. He says these words, to me and to you here and now, like he said to those dispersed and scattered because of persecution, facing arrest, imprisonment, and death, he says, consider it all joy, my brothers, my sisters, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith will produce endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. First words after, hi, it's me, is consider it all joy, count it all joy, determined to be full of joy in the midst of the circumstances that are scary. Think about it, folks. It's like Syria. They ran from home. They left jobs and career. When I was in Greece last summer, I met a Nigerian man in Greece. What are you doing here? The Boko Haram were threatening me, and they said, either come and work for us or we'll kill your family. Successful businessman left house, career, cars, everything, and fled to Greece with nothing but his children and a pregnant wife. These people fled without home and without resource to go and live off the land or whatever it was because of the circumstances. And James is writing them saying, determine that this is joyful. Now, my circumstances sometimes aren't so joyful, and yours may not be either. So I want to just pause here, and I want you to look back in the rearview mirror of your life at some of the most painful times. Now, you could be right now in the most painful time of your entire life because they come. But I want you to think in your mind some of those most painful times when you were hurt, abused, neglected, uncared for, unloved, accused, damaged, whatever that was, financial, relational, marital, whatever it might be. I want you to pull that into your rearview mirror for a moment. Focus on that as I tell you one of mine. When I was 18 years old, almost 19 years old, my sister, who was my senior, she, the only sibling, it was just the two of us, she was to have a surgery. And when they opened up her neck to take care of these growths in her neck, the doctor said, you have cancer in your lymph nodes that has come from your brain. You have brain cancer, and you'll be dead in 6 months. I'm 18, she's 23. That hit my family like an atomic bomb. And I remember getting in my car because I just found out my brother-in-law had just told my sister that news. She was out of the surgery, and he told her that news. And I got in my car. I'm driving to the hospital to now see her. Tears are streaming down my face so much I can hardly look out my windshield, just trying to be able to blink them away and drive. But the first Bible study I ever did was the same passage. First one I ever did. And I'm saying to the Lord, thank you. I don't understand. I'm praying, God, you give her longer life. I'm asking you to extend her life. I'm asking you to heal her. But I'm thanking you in the circumstance right now that I can't comprehend. because I know you're good. So I thanked him for the 18 years I'd had my sister and for the remaining 6 months or whatever it was that he would allow us to share. I just thanked him in the midst of the worst news I had received to date. So how about you? When you get news, when you have an experience, and it's hard and it's painful, how are you dealing with that? I want to tell you a little bit of a story. Some of you maybe get World Magazine. Maybe you've seen this woman's face before. Her name is Rachel Denhollander. And Rachel was one of the people that blew the whistle on a man named Dr. Larry, what's his name? I just went blank on his name. Nassar, sorry. And Dr. Larry was convicted of abusing girls while he was taking care of them. They were American gymnasts. You remember that? It was just a couple months ago. During the sentencing, they allowed any woman that had been abused to come forward. 156 women testified over 7 days. And the last one was this lady, Rachel. And I want to read you some quotes just from the magazine about what she said, because my breath was taken away as I watched this on the news, and then they captured this quote. And I want you to imagine that this is the darkest hours that these young women have ever experienced. And so here's what the quote says. The article was written by Jamie Dean, and she said, she told him the Bible speaks of, quote, a final judgment where all of God's wrath and eternal terror is poured out on men like you. She said she prayed that he would feel the soul-crushing weight of guilt. Those are some hard words, aren't they? But listen to the next words. So you may someday experience true repentance and true forgiveness from God, which you need far more than forgiveness from me, though I extend that to you as well. Denhollander says Nassar needed to hear the gospel, and she thought it was her only chance that she'd speak to him again. So Rachel was focusing on two things simultaneously: justice, which was being served, he would never again be a free man, and redemption. That he, in all of his sinfulness, just like me in all of my sinfulness, could receive redemption. The pain of my sin debt. The pain of his sin debt. That the debt would be done away with. That salvation would be offered. That the guilt would be taken care of. That's what she spoke to the man who had violated her and at least 156 women. So I like to read, and I like to read Christian authors, and one of them is a man, Dr. Neil T. Anderson, and he wrote a book called Victory Over Darkness. I want to give you just a quote. Here's what he wrote, and he asked this question. So before I read the question, get in your own skin again. Where are those painful places, those horrible places, those events that you had happen in your life? You caused it, somebody else caused it, some wreckage in your life. Where are they? Now, with that in your head, he asked the question, where was God when all this was going on? And then he responds. The omnipresent God was there, and he sent his own son to redeem you from your past. The truth is, he is in your life right now, desiring to set you free from your past. This is the gospel, the good news that Christ has come to set the captives free. Perceiving those events from the perspective of your new identity in Christ is what starts the process of healing those damaged emotions. Recognizing that he was there while these girls were being violated by this doctor, while what was happening in your life was going on, while the divorce was taking place, where the abandonment took place, whatever the story is that's in our individual stories in here, while that was happening, God was present doing a redemptive work in us and through us for the rest of our lives. He was writing a redemptive story, and today, in the circumstances we're walking in today, he's still writing a redemptive story. Whether we can see it or not. And most of the time, we can't see it. So if you would you turn to Philippians chapter 1? Just turn your Bibles, Philippians chapter 1. I'm not going to take the time to read all of that chapter. I'm going to hopscotch through three different parts of that first chapter just as you follow along. But to give you the historical background, Paul wrote four different letters, we call them epistles, while he was in prison. And imagine he's in prison for an extended period of time, and he's chained to a Roman guard, a palace guard. They were called the Praetorian Guard. There were 9,000 of them that took turns. And so he has a chance to talk to them. And they have a chance to listen to him, those that wanted to. So Philippians chapter 1, beginning with verse 1, it says, Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all God's holy people in Christ at Philippi, which is where he planted a church, Paul did. Together with the overseers and deacons, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you in all my prayers for all of you. I always pray with joy. This guy's in prison, remember this? With joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. Being confident of this, that he, who's the he? Who's the he? Christ. He who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Now, this is verse 12, excuse me, skip down to verse 12. Now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard. How many guards was that? 9,000 of them. And to everyone else, that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by what? By death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is... Those are some powerful words. This passage is all about redemption. In fact, I want to say this to you. I hope you understand this. The Bible, from Genesis chapter 3, verse 21, is where I see it start, till Revelation chapter 22, the end of the book. The book is about the redemptive work of God in all creation, in all humanity, in all of our broken world and our broken politics and our broken society and our broken lives. He is doing a redemptive work in us and therefore also wanting to do that same redemptive work through us to other people. That's what the story of the Bible is all about. So now verse 6, he says something. I want to ask you if this applies to your life. Verse 6, he says, he, Jesus Christ, who began a good work in you, will carry it on to completion. So I've asked you to think of some bad things that have been a part of your life. Maybe they're major failures, moral failures that you've done, or maybe things that people have done to you. But with that question, is it really true in your situation that he is doing a redemptive work and he's going to carry it to completion? Amen? Is it true, really true, in your struggles? Is it really true in your addictions, in your secrets, in the shameful places of your life? Is it really true there? And you may say, I don't know how to answer that, because when I'm there, it doesn't feel like it. Okay? Feelings are giving us red lights, but reality and truth is what we always want to base our life on. So, is God redeeming you and me even when we sin? Can God be doing a redemptive work while I'm sinning? I believe yes. Is God doing a redemptive work in your life while you're sinning? I believe the answer to that is yes. Is God doing a redemptive work in our lives when someone else is sinning against us and or against our beloved? A son, a daughter, a husband, a wife. That happens all the time, folks. People sin against us and our beloved as we do to others also. And God, in the midst of the hard and the horrible and the painful, he is doing a redemptive work. Verse 12 says, now I want you to know, brothers and sisters, I love this part. This is where we're kind of camping on, right here. I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that what has happened to me, what's happened to him? He's in jail, chained to Roman guards. That's what he's talking about. What's happened to me? My freedom is taken away. I don't get to choose when I go, where I go anymore. I am chained to a Roman guard. What has happened to me has actually served to advance the gospel. As a result, it has become clear throughout the whole palace guard, again, that's that 9,000, and to everyone else that I am in chains for Christ. And because of my chains, most of the brothers and sisters have become confident in the Lord and dare all the more to proclaim the gospel without fear. Paul is in prison. He is suffering, he's chained, and he's praising God because in his now circumstances, the gospel is going forward. In the prison, to the palace guards, who would also be guarding all the important people, and even now, those outside of prison that are Christians, brothers and sisters in the Lord, are becoming bold in their faith because of his suffering. Did you know that the suffering that you've gone through, and maybe it's because of your own sinful choices, like much of mine is because of my sinful choices, that suffering is something that we are to share, to let other people know the redemptive story that God is writing in our lives? There's a man, I love to read his books. Dan Allender is his name. Dan's written many books, but one of them he wrote is called To Be Told. And the message of the story of the whole book is very simple. God is doing a redemptive work in my life. I need to tell you those stories. God is doing a redemptive work in your life, and you need to tell me your stories to me. But also, we need to tell the stories we hear from each other to other people that they would benefit from the redemptive stories that's happened. We tell the stories of David and Paul, and we tell all these stories in the Bible, but we tell stories of one another's lives. My friend told me this, and this is what happened, and this is what God did. We're to be passing on these redemptive stories. And Paul here is an inmate, and he's writing encouragement to the people that are free. Now, I mentioned to you I've been going to the men's central jail. That's just one time. I've been just recently, in the last 3 months or so, been down to Mexico to go to the Tijuana jail and go into the one below Tecate. And we go in there, we use eyeglasses as the doorway to have opportunity to share the gospel, and then we tell our personal testimony, and then we ask them if they'd like to hear the greatest news we know, the gospel of Jesus Christ. My first time in Mexico at jail, by the way, I'm going to say something to you. I'd like to invite you to join me in the Mexican jail. Now, I never thought I'd say those sentences in my life. That's just a bizarre sentence, especially to say at church. But if y'all want to come to jail with me in Mexico, I'll take you along, okay? And if you really are interested in that, I can tell you how we do that. But we go in, we give these people glasses, both prescription and reader's glasses, and then we sit down and tell our story. And then we ask them, do they have a story like that? And then after that, we give them the gospel. Now, the first time I did it with Rick. So imagine a little card table, and I'm sitting here, Rick's here, an inmate translator, speaks both languages, Spanish and English, and then an inmate, one at a time, and they're doing this all over the room. One at a time, they come up, and we then share the gospel. And then we ask, do you have a story like that? 21 people that day we talked to, one at a time. Two of the 21 had become Christians prior to incarceration. Christians do make bad choices. Okay, you and I are not above making a bad choice, even as a believer in Christ. So they got themselves incarcerated. About 14 or so of them had become believers in prison already. And some of them there are 5 and 10 years already and so on. And there's a ministry, and that's what we're joining, is that ministry there in Mexico. And then the rest of them, when we gave them the gospel, they all responded with a yes. So 21 out of 21 walked up at our table. 21 out of 21 walked away followers of Jesus. And we had the privilege to introduce 5 or 6 or whatever it was to Jesus Christ that day. What a wonderful opportunity. I love it. When I went that one time, I said, I'm going back. And then I went back, and I'm going to go back, and I'll go back. This ministry goes about once a month. So if you're interested in knowing about that, I'd be glad to tell you more about that. But here's Paul. He's not a visitor like me. Walk in, you know, go through all the security things, and then walk out free, man. I walked in freely, left free. Paul's in there, and he can't go. He can't leave. He is under arrest. Now, I want to tell you more about this redemptive story. Remember I said hearing stories and telling stories is what we're to do? That was Dan Allender. Karen and I, about a year and a half, almost 2 years ago, we took a 10-day vacation. We flew to Arlington, Texas, where we had done ministry for about almost 8 years in Arlington. And so we had lots of friends there. And then we drove up to Oklahoma, which is where my mother's from, and to see family. So 10-day trip. But before we went, we contacted people, mostly Facebook, but some texts and some emails. So, hey, we're coming to town. We'd love to see you. Let us know when you're available. You know, our calendar might fill up. And sure enough, we had 20 face-to-face appointments. 20. In that 7 days, we sat down face-to-face, breakfast with somebody, lunch with somebody different, coffee with somebody different, and dinner with somebody different. We're all over Arlington, and then all up, and then we stayed in one house, and people came to us that were family. But here's what happened. The first woman that sat down with us at a coffee shop, all we asked for all of them, tell us about your life since the last time we were together. That's the question. And they'd start telling. Every one of them had some really hard stuff they told us about. Some of them were 5 years ago, 10, 20, and some of the people we saw we hadn't seen for 30 years. And they start telling us these stories. Every one had ugly, hurt, divorce, abortion, immorality, something in their story. All kinds of painful things that had gone on in their lives. But the first one, when she told us, she said what God was doing. It was a story of redemption. And Karen and I got out and walked to the car. I said, Karen, that was a beautiful story of redemption. She goes, yeah. And then we met with somebody else. And they told us their story. And it was kind of a, but God, the redemptive part. And then the next one. And pretty soon, after about four of those, we said, I bet we're going to hear a story of redemption. And all we do is ask a question. Tell us about your life since last time. And it, person after person after person, even one who was in process of divorce number two because wife number one and then wife number two found another lover, was telling us a story of redemption. Blew us away. 100%. 100% had a story of redemption. And some of them were heart-shattering to hear what they had gone through. Redemption is best seen usually in the rear view mirror as we look back. Most of the time, we don't see it happening in the situation, in the season we're living in. We're wondering, where are you, God? What's going on? Aren't you here? And we cry out our hearts to him, and yet we're not seeing what he is doing. There's a little poem called The Weaver, and I can't quote it for you, but it basically says that God is choosing the bright colors and the dark colors, and that he sees the upper side when all we're seeing is the downside, the underside of a weaving. But he says even all the colors are necessary for our lives. So he chooses the dark colors in our lives that are part of what he wants to reveal his glory in our lives. So let's pick up in verse 18. It says, I will continue to rejoice, for I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. What's he saying there, that live for Christ and die for is gain? He's saying, when every moment that I am living my life purposefully for him, it brings him glory. Now, there are moments in my life that I'm doing that. I'm living for his honor and glory. And there are other moments I live selfishly for my want or whatever. And that doesn't bring him honor and glory as I'm living. But he's still working his redemptive work, even in the midst of my sin-filled choices. So he's talking about here, I live for his honor and his glory. He's saying that glorifies Christ. But he says, if I die, that's gain. And Paul is wanting to be with the Lord. He's in love with the Lord. He's living his life for the Lord because for me, to go home would be glorious. You know, I feel like if we were to compare what heaven is like, which we don't know, you know, the song, I Can Only Imagine, we only can imagine, but we don't know what it's like. All I can say is we're like in black and white and two-dimensional, and here's this glorious four, five, six-dimensional, whatever it is, technicolor experience, intimate experience with God that we can't even imagine. And that's the difference that he's saying. So to go home to be with the Lord, that's it. So remember where we started. I was telling you about James chapter 1. Consider it all joy, my brothers, sisters, when, not if, you encounter these various trials, these heartaches of life, these shattering times. And like I said, you may be in it right this second. So what do? We say, God, I'm frustrated, I'm hurt, I'm desperate, I'm lonely. Spill it out. And God, I can't even hear you. I don't sense you. That's okay. We can, if I want to say that, we can barf up on God. He's okay with that. He doesn't need it pristine. Every naughty word you've ever said or anyone else ever said, he's heard them all. So we don't have to be pristine with God, okay? He's seen all of our junk. We don't have to make it churchy for him. So God, I don't get it. I don't understand. I'm begging you. We can say all of that. But God, because all of my history that I can understand so far, you've been good. And I'm going to go by that. And what you say in your word about who you are, I'm going to go by that. And I'm going to, with all that I can, try to thank you in the midst of the storm. I'm going to thank you now. And when I look back on those horrible things that happened to me and my beloved, I'm going to thank you because I know you were there, you were present, you were good. I'm going to thank you. That's a faith decision. So I'm going to ask you, will you today choose those things that maybe, and maybe really what we've done is we haven't even forgiven God. Now understand that there's a sentence full of stuff. But when we're hurt and we can't see God, we hold God accountable for that in our hearts. Now, God never sins. He's never done anything unjust ever. But in our perspective, he wronged us. He let it happen. You're all good and you're all powerful and you're all present and you let that happen. This doesn't make sense to me. But we can come to the point where we say, but I'm trusting you, so I'm letting you off of my sin hook that you didn't really commit, but I'm letting you off of that. I'm going to say thank you. I'm going to thank you in the midst of my storm in the past. It goes back to what Scripture says. Paul wrote in Romans 8:28, he says, and we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. You remember Joseph? If you ever saw the play, the Technicolor, what was it? Technicolor Dreamcoat. That's what. Thank you. The musician in the house knows that, and the pastor doesn't. Thank you, Phil. He was a follower of God, and he got slammed by his brothers. They threw him in a pit, sold him off as a slave, and he winds up in Egypt. And when the story goes fast forward to the end of the story, he rescues Egypt, and he rescues his family. 72 of his family members all live because of God working through Joseph. And here's what Joseph says. One verse only, and we'll wrap this thing up. He says, you intended to harm me. They wanted him dead. They just weren't brave enough to kill him. You wanted to harm me, but God intended it for good to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. All these Egyptians and all of my family. So people have done harmful things. Their words, they lied about you, they lied to you, whatever it's been, they intended harm. And God intended good for the redemption, for the salvation of the many. I recently heard a song, called Scars. And I don't know about you, but most people don't get out of life here on earth without scars on their body. Maybe if you're a fortunate one, praise God for you, but I've got scars all over my body from different things that have taken place. But this is about soul scars more than anything. So we're going to play the video right up here right now and just want you to pay attention to the words. And it's talking about thanking God for the scars. Pay attention to whose scars he's talking about. Let's play that. Thanks, Daryl.
Waking up to a new sunrise, looking back from the other side, I can see now with open eyes, darkest water and deepest pain, been traded for anything. 'Cause my brokenness brought me to you, and these wounds are a story we'll use. So I'm thankful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart. And I know they'll always tell of who you are. So forever I am thankful for the scars. Now I'm sending you confidence with the strength of your faithfulness. And I'm not who I was before. No, I don't have to fear anymore. So I'm faithful for the scars, 'cause without them I wouldn't know your heart.
Scars are the scars in our own lives, our hearts, our souls, but they're also the scars, Jesus' hands and feet and side, brow. We can thank God. It's a lot easier to thank God for his scars on his hands and feet and brow and side. Not quite so easy for us to thank God for the scars. I've been in ministry a long time, and I've seen the scars of abortion, and I've seen the scars of homosexuality. I've seen the scars. You can't name a sin of any kind I haven't seen the scars. Been up close and personal with people as they've walked through, and they've begun to experience his freedom, his cleansing, his redemption. That's what he's doing all the time. And so I want to just suggest that, kind of as we close this part of the service, that maybe you would stand with me, and here's what I'm going to recommend, that we stand with our hands like this, thinking of those scars. Like, maybe you're like me, I have scars on my hands even. In the front of my hands, in the back of my hands, I got scars. Maybe you got scars even there, and you might even see some of them. But as you look at your hands, you might think of that gossip or that slander or that thing that happened to you, or that choice you made that damaged so many that you wished you hadn't. But if you could hold them in your hands, say, God, I'm thankful for my scars because they've revealed your grace, your redemption. I'm going to offer them to you. And Lord, the ones that maybe right now I'm just not ready to deal with it, help me in the future to be able to thank you for those scars. I mean, I remember putting a scar on my own son. And to this day, you still see it. Breaks my heart. I scarred my son. But I scarred his soul more than I scarred his body. So would you stand with me if you desire to hold out to God, hold out to him, offer to him. This is our offering to the Lord right now, to offer our scars and thanking him for those tragic, horrible things that have happened in our lives and our beloved lives. So would you whisper those things to him right now, just between you and him? Lord, I hardly can think of people I haven't scarred somehow. My wife, my children, my parents, my sister, other beloved and friends. I've inflicted a lot of scars. And there's been a good batch that's been inflicted in my soul. And I'm, because you're the redemptive one, I'm going to thank you for those scars. And I'm asking God that we could bring those to you right now and offer them to you truly as our offering, to say, God, we trust you that you were present and in the midst of ugly and in the midst of evil, in the midst of sinfulness, you were still working out redemptive good. We trust you with that. I pray for those that right now, God, are struggling. This is overwhelmingly painful for them right now. Those that want to just run out the door. And I just pray for your comfort and your continued grace and mercy, your love, your redemptive work in their lives. I thank you that you love us even when we're very unlovely. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen.